spots last yesterday. So just briefly bring everyone back in memory to the place where we left off. So we ended up by saying that we basically have two or three ideas how to use bare bones spaces, which means spaces of square integrable holomorphic functions on some domains or more generally manifolds. I will come to that in a moment. One of them was this Burrs and Tablets quantization, which means using Tablets operators for quantization. So this is precisely what Professor Schlittenmeier is doing in the more general context of Carroll manifolds. And in essence, it means we are trying to find a family of weights, rows of h being interpreted as a Planck constant, and which is a small positive parameter in our model, which eventually we allow to tend to zero, and as h tends to zero, we would like to have an asymptotic expansion of the product of two Tablets operators into an asymptotic series of single Tablets operators. So this Cj, these coefficients, should be some bidifferential operators, so the leading order term should be just a pointwise product, and the first order term after n-tesimalizing should give the Poisson bracket with the appropriate constant in front. And we have seen this work with when the domain was the all of the entire complex plane, or more generally C2N, where we took down the Fock spaces. The second was when Bayesian tablets by Bayesian quantization, which was constructed using the Bayesian symbols of operators. So for each operator T on the Bergman space, we have its Bayesian symbol to twiddle. This is a one-to-one correspondence. The twiddle is a function, and we define the product of these twiddles of functions by transferring the operator multiplication. And again, this is something which depends on the weight, which we use in the construction of the weighted Bergman space. And the goal is again to find a family of weights indexed by the Planck constant, such that when h tends to zero, this again yields an asymptotic series, a star product. As a small power series in H with this Cj, the coefficients, sometimes they are called co-chains due to the algebraic homology interpretation, Hochschild co-chains, that's what they are. This should be some bidifferential operators, again, the leading order one should be just pointwise product, the first order one, anti-centralizing should be the Poisson bracket with the appropriate multiple. And there is also an alternative description of the last, more precisely, the Bayesian quantization from the preceding slide, not the Bayesian tablets, but the Bayesian, can be reduced to just getting the asymptotic expansion of the corresponding Bayesian transform. Bayesian transform recall was the Bayesian symbol of tablets operator, so it is something, is a transform which sends functions to functions. And again, depends on the Planck constant, so we should choose the weights in such, depending on the Planck constant, h again in such a way that as h tends to zero, we have an expansion of the Bayesian transform in powers of h into a formal power series with coefficients which are differential operators. The leading order one should be just the identity operator, and from the other ones, we then get these Cj's, and we get so just precisely the Bayesian star product from the preceding slides. This is something which we proved at the end of yesterday's lecture. So now let me show you some examples how this star works. The first one is the one we already had two lectures ago, which is that of the complex of the Fock space on C, or more generally on Cn. So we take the Gaussian measures as a weight we take e2 minus alpha times multi square times a normalizing constant alpha over pi to power n. We make it of total mass 1, which is just for convenience. The reproducing curve is then just the exponential. And we make the Bayesian transform. So recall it was an integral transform acting from functions to functions, and this was an integral curve in terms of the reproducing curve. So if we insert this into general formula, then we just end up with the dimensional mystery of the alpha to the power pi to power n, the dimension is missing here, times this integral transform of the function f,
Now, anyone who has had a PDE curves knows what this is. This is precisely the heat solution of the heat equation. So this is the solution of the equation that the Laplace of f of the function equals the time derivative of the function, and this applied at the time of 1 over 4 a, so 1 over 4 alpha. So in other words, the Bresnik transform corresponding to this problem of alpha is just the exponential of Laplacian over 4 alpha applied to f. So this means that the Bayesian transform of the Fock space is a very familiar object, and expanding the exponential into the Taylor series, which of course would need some technical justification, but one can, everything works out fine, and one can show that the Bayesian transform indeed has this kind of asymptotic expansion as alpha tends to infinity. So we're taking for, instead of alpha, we take 1 over h, we interpret alpha as 1 over the Planck constant. This then means Planck constant h tends to 0. And we get precisely the asymptotic expansion of the Bayesian transform into the powers of h, which means negative powers of alpha. So the leading order term is just the identity operator, d alpha f is asymptotic to f. The first order is Laplacian of 4. Second is Laplacian square over 2 times 4 square, whatever that is, and so on. So we get this kind of asymptotic expansion for the Bayesian transform, and from that, as we saw 2 slides ago, it follows that we have the Bayesian quantization with these options for chain Cj. And we have seen 2 days ago that we also have Bayesian tablets quantization, we prove that for polynomials at least at G, which looks the same, except there is a factor of minus 1 to j here, and the homomorphic and anti-homomorphic derivatives are interchanged. So there are 2 different motivations in the terminology that Professor Schliefmeier introduced at the end of his lecture yesterday in the physics department. So that was, this one would be the product with separation of variables. This is also a separation of variables, but with the holomorphic and anti-holomorphic roles interchanged. So this one is actually called anti-weak, this one is called the weak separation of variables, sometimes in the literature. So of course both these are quantization of the Euclidean Poisson bracket on Cn, or the answer to n, if you want. From the beginning of this lecture course. Second example, we take the unit disk, or for those of you who prefer that, the non-Euclidean model for the Poincaré half plane. So there we take the unit disk, and the as a weight we take, again, will depend on the parameter alpha, which eventually will become 1 over the Planck constant, 1 over h, and we take the weights as alpha. 1 minus modi squared to power alpha, again times some constant factor, in this case alpha plus 1 over pi to make this probability measure. This is without the constant factor, it would also work, but just with the whole formula, so there would be a lot of constant factors to break around. The reproducing term is then given by this simple expression. And the Bayesian transform, again, if you feed this into the general formula, you get this expression for the Bayesian transform. So this is already quite a complicated integral, but it can again be handled by standard methods to show what happens when alpha tends to plus infinity. And one sees again that one gets an asymptotic expansion for this Bayesian transform of the type we need, namely the leading order is the identity operator, then the first order term is the invariant Laplacian. This 1 minus modi squared times the union of Euclidean Laplacian. So this is also the Laplace-Beltrami operator with respect to the hypervolumetric on the disk. So this over 4 alpha, just as we had for the Fock space, except the Euclidean Laplacian on the Fock space is replaced by this delta twiddle, the Poincaré Laplacian on the disk. And there are also higher order terms. So from that we again, by the general ansatz that we had yesterday, we see that we have the Bayesian quantization with this CZU leading order terms and first order term coefficients. There are also the higher order CJ, higher order coefficients, higher order tau chains, but explicit formulas for these are now. One can try to get them, they involve Bernoulli numbers,
it's easy to compute the first 100 on a computer if you are interested in doing that, but there is no general formula for the CJ. One also gets a burden in terms of quantization, one can show that it works, and one gets the CJ slightly different, actually minus one of this, this FMG again interchange, the holomorphic, the anti-holomorphic derivatives interchange. Again, the higher order CJ, they are there, but no, no nice explicit expression for that is known. Even in the second simplest example of the only disk, the simplest one, the Fox space. So both this burden and burden tablets quantize this invariant Poisson bracket, which is associated to the Poincaré Lomachevsky magic of the pseudo-hyperbolic magic of the disk. One can, third example, of course, go to higher dimensions and instead of this consider the unit volume Cn. Again, with the measure 1 minus mod z squared to some power alpha, alpha a positive, one can take it bigger than minus 1. Parameter, the C sub alpha, a constant to make things of total mass 1 just for numerical convenience. The reproducing kernel is then given by this formula, which generalizes the 1 for the disk, which is just a special case of n being equal to 1. One gets a Bayesian transform, again the same thing as for the disk happens, so we get the formula for the Bayesian asymptotic expansion for the Bayesian transform. Here we get the invariant Laplacian of the ball, which is slightly more complicated than on the disk, but it is still there. And we get the Bayesian and Bayesian for Tepes quantizations. So these are three examples. Here is a summary for what we can learn from the examples. So, We had the weights, which were on the Fox space, we had the Gaussian weight, e to minus alpha mod z square on the disk and the ball. We had a 1 minus mod z square to some power alpha. Alpha was in all cases just 1 over Planck constant, so alpha tending to infinity, or the same thing as the Planck constant tending to 0. And the reproducing kernels were basically, you see, when these were the formulas for the reproducing kernels. If you just take them on the diagonal for x equal to y, so you basically up to these constant factors in front, you just recover, here you will get e to alpha times norm x squared, here we have e to minus alpha times norm x squared. So basically it will be just a reciprocal of the weight up to these constant factors. Similarly here, when we take y equal to x, when we restrict the kernel to the diagonal, We just get the reciprocal of the weight except for the constant factor, and instead so we shift by 2. Instead of minus alpha, we have minus alpha minus 2. On the unit ball, similarly, we had setting x equal to y. We again have basically the reciprocal of the weight. So 1 minus mod x squared power minus alpha, here is power plus alpha, up to this constant factor and up to the shift by instead of minus alpha, we get minus alpha, minus n, minus 1. So in some sense, we want to expect perhaps is that the kernel will be some kind of reciprocal of our weight, which we need. And also in all cases, the Bayesian transform was an approximate identity, and the first order term was some kind of Laplace-Beltrami operator associated to the geometry, to the symplectic form or to the Kerlo form which you are quantizing. So this is something which gives an idea how one should approach the general situation. So we to keep that program, we just start with the domain omega in Cn. We are given some Poisson brackets there which we would like to quantize. So in general, this is a Poisson bracket is an anti-symmetric 1-1 form. So it is given by this formula in local coordinates. And where g sub j bar k are just some coefficients in local shard. Since we have our domain, this is actually one local shard, which is the domain itself. So on many folks view, this would just be a local expression. And this is a non-degenerate skew Hermitian anti-symmetric anti-Hermitian matrix. And we also have the differential form for these coefficients, which and so it will be denoted omega. It's n exterior powers and determines a non-vanishing volume on omega. So it's just standard tools from the Riemannian geometry. So we will now, this is given, and we want to find these weights, rho,
sub h, depending on the parameter plus constant h on our domain omega, a family of weights depending on the Planck constant, such that we could carry out this Borasian and Borasian typeless quantization using the Berman, weighted Berman spaces with respect to these weights. So how should we choose these weights? And there is this is the first question. So for the preceding slide, for the fog space and the disk, these weights work, but how to get them in general? So there is a guidance, a heuristical derivation of what you should do, which you can take guidance from by looking what happens when you have a group of symmetries acting on your omega, and you want to make things invariant under the action of this group. So assume there is a group acting on our domain omega in CN by biholomorphic transformations, which preserve everything around, preserve the properties of the system, so they should preserve in particular this Poisson structure and the corresponding form omega. And then in that situation, when everything is invariant under this group, we would like, of course, also our quantization of our star products, the Borasian and Borasian typeless star product, are invariant under this group action. So for any element phi of the group, if you and any two functions f and g, we take f composed with phi and g composed with phi, make the star product. This should be the same thing that as first taking the star product of f and g and then composing with phi. So we want to have everything group invariant. If you go through the formulas, what this means for the trapeze operator and for the Borasian quantization, so this corresponds to the Borasian transform, from which you derive your Borasian quantization, and in some sense also the Borasian trapeze one. This we showed at the end of last talk. Then it means that the Borasian transform itself should commute with this group action. So the Borasian transform of some function f composed with this group element phi, for any phi in the group, should be just the Borasian transform first and then composed with this group. So this should be true. Now, if you recall that the Borasian transform is an integral operator given by some kernel, this integral kernel in terms of the reproducing kernel k, then a simple examination of the formula tells you that the Borasian transform is invariant like this if you have this equality for all phi's in the group. So in other words, this expression should be invariant under the group action. Okay. This means in particle that this ratio should be just equal to this ratio. It's just from the previous formula, we just flip everything to right and left sides as we like. And the right-hand side here is just a squared modulus of holomorphic function. Recall this kxy is something which is holomorphic in x and anti-holomorphic in y. So this is a modulus squared of holomorphic function in x or in x. Now here we have Lebesgue measures, dx and d phi of x. We have this nice invariant measure around omega to n. This is the invariant volume of our manifold. So instead of having weights with respect to Lebesgue measures, weights rho with respect to the Lebesgue measures we have here, let's just introduce weights w with respect to this volume element. So this is W will be rho divided by the determinant of the coefficients of this form omega. So this is just a change of the reference measure. So this of course, the advantage is that this omega to n is group invariant. So this last condition translates into a simple condition on this weight W, which is for our weight with respect not to the Lebesgue measure, but with respect to the omega to n, to the invariant volume, the invariant volume element. It just says that the weight W should satisfy this condition. The W of phi of x for any phi holomorphic phi from the group should be W of x times the modulus square of some holomorphic function. Now, if modulus square of holomorphic function is something which vanishes when you take the logarithm and apply dd bar to that. So this just tells you that the 2-1-1 form of dd bar of logarithm of the weight w should be g invariant. And of course, there is a very simple choice for a g invariant form. This is just the form omega you have there. There may be, oops, the computer is doing what I don't want it to do. It's just the form omega, which is group invariant by hypothesis, and if the group is actually sufficiently rich, then this is the only G invariant form. Like if you have the context of the Euclidean space and you take all your groups, your rotations and translations, the only metric invariant on CN invariant are the rotations and translations of the Euclidean metric. So similarly, the only form invariant under rotations and translations on CN will be just the Euclidean form omega. So in this case, it means that DD log W should be just a constant, which we denote by minus C, constant multiple of this form of our form omega. This means that first of all, omega must lie in the range of DD bar, which means that the metric is actually not just any symplectic Riemannian, the form is not just any symplectic form, but it is actually a Keller form. This DD bar of function which produces this omega upon taking DD bar is called a Keller potential. And secondly, from this formula, you get that omega to n should be just to the terminal of DD bar of this phi. So in other words, this weight which we want, if you trace back through the calculations which we did, this rho sub n should be just e to minus a constant times the Keller potential of our metric times the volume element corresponding to our metric. So this is and this C is then something which of course should depend on the Planck constant. So here we get this is what group invariance tells us, is the only sensible choice for having the weights in the Bayesian or Bayesian tennis potential. Some remarks before continuing. This Keller potential phi is a function when you take mixed second order derivatives, it reproduces the metric which is the inverse. The coefficients are the inverse metrics of the ones of this form omega, so in particles they are positive definite. So functions for which this matrix of second order mixed derivatives, d bar of phi, is a positive definite, they are called strictly plural subharmonic. So this phi needs to be the Keller potential is always a strictly plural subharmonic function because it defines a positive definite metric, positive definite Keller form. We wanted to have the conditions of the first order term in the asymptotic expansion of Bayesian transform, polarization upon anti-symmetrizing should give the Poisson bracket with some constant in front. This will be satisfied if this operator Q1 in the first order term in the asymptotic expansion of the Bayesian transform is just the Laplace Beltrami operator for our form. So this is also precisely what we had for the Fock space and for the basic examples. And then things indeed work. So we have thus arrived at the final recipe how to carry out the Bayesian and Bayesian tennis quantizations on a domain omega in CN with some given Poisson bracket. So here is the recipe. We need the metric to be Keller and have a Keller potential. So it is of the form dd by far for some real valued function, strictly plural subharmonic function, phi capital phi. Then we take the weighted Bergmann spaces with respect to this weight, exponential of minus c, c some constant depending, real constant depending on the Planck parameter, e to minus c phi times the determinant of dd bar phi, so times the volume element corresponding to this metric dd bar phi, to this Keller metric. So we take the subspace of holomorphic functions L2 as a weighted Bergmann space with respect to this weight. We take the corresponding reproducing kernel, from that we get the corresponding associated Bayesian transform, and we get the corresponding trapeze operators. They will all depend on this constant C. And now we need to see if this constant can be made to depend on the Planck constant H in such a way that these Bayesian transforms have an asymptotic expansion as H tends to zero into where the first order term into a formal power series of H, where the first order term, the leading order term should be the identities, the first order one should be just the Laplace-Beltrami operator and some higher order ones. And
So this is for the Bayesian quantization, and for the Bayesian tapless quantization, we should have that the product of two tapless operators is given by an asymptotic series as h tends to zero in some single tapless operators, depending on some CGAs, which again the leading order term one should be just a pointwise product, the first order one after n times some tries, and you should give the force of vacuum, the application of some factor in front of it. So this is the recipe, what to do, and the answer is that it's good, it works. And actually the simple choice for the constant C is just one over the Planck constant, like we had in the examples a short while ago. So how do we prove that? We need the asymptotic of the Bayesian transform and the product of two tapless operators. So both Bayesian transform is an integral operator involving the reproducing kernels. The signal as a tapless operator can be shown to be given by a formula involving the reproducing kernel Kc. So we need to understand the asymptotics of the reproducing kernels Kc as h tends to zero. And so the reproducing kernels of these weighted Bergmann spaces. And so this is what we do now. And this is just a recapitulation of what I just said. And so this is what we need to do now. Before going on, let me make some remarks about what happens in more general situation. And so far we have been talking about domains in CN. We could do it also on manifolds. This is what Professor Schlichtmeier has been doing from the beginning. The difference there is now that on the domains we have functions, holomorphic functions, spaces of square integral of holomorphic functions, meaning weighted Bergmann spaces. On manifolds, more generally, it's not enough to consider only functions. If the manifold is compact, then there are no holomorphic functions except the constants, and this is not much to work with. So, first of all, instead of functions, we need more generally consider sections of some holomorphic line bundles. And the formula which we had here for these L2 spaces with respect to these weights, so this becomes very nicely interpreted in that context, namely this part e to minus c times phi, this will be just the c tends the power to of c over the Hermitian line bundle, where the Hermitian metric is fiber-wise given by e to minus psi. So and this d bar psi is just the volume element of the manifold. So in other words, the line bundle, holomorphic line bundle whose sections we need to consider instead of functions, is just the line bundle whose Hermitian metric in the fibers should locally be given by e to minus phi, where phi is the Kelvin potential of your metric. In other words, the curvature form of this Hermitian metric in the line bundle should be just minus omega minus the given Kelvin form. And then one should take tensor powers instead of this constant C, then should be an integer M, because in general, if you are given a manifold not simply connected, you can only take integer powers otherwise there may be some issues with non-uniqueness of the power. So the Planck constant just takes only values which are reciprocals of integers, 1, 1 over 2, 1 over 3, and so on. And for such a line bundle to exist with a given curvature form, of course, it means that the curvature form, the Kelvin form you are given on the manifold, should have integral areas, so it should satisfy should be an element of the second cohomology group with interior coefficients instead of just real coefficients. So this is the usual cause of a quantization rule, which you also have in geometric quantization. There are two approaches how to prove what I mentioned, with all these choices that I just explained that the Bayesian and Bayesian tapless quantizations work. These are actually historically, although I mentioned domains all the time, and from a lot of points of view, the main analysis, the main work one needs to do is eventually in some local charts, as this is always in the differential geometry. Then, historically, it was first done with compact manifolds, where Zeldich in 1998 in a nice paper got the asymptotics of, in our terminology, the asymptotic of this weighted Berman curves on the diagonal as h tends to zero. One year later, Kaplan did the same also away from the diagonal. So these two consider just the reproducing kernels, not the Bresen transform and not the Tetris operators. Also, their motivation came from different areas. They were inspired by some work of Qian and Xinpeng Yao concerning the approximation of a given metric by metrics coming from projective embeddings. So basically approximating by a given metric by projectively induced Perelman metrics or Fubini-Sturi metrics. So this was, they had the reproducing kernels but not Bresen transform Tetris operators, and the proof that the Kaplan especially did, but also Zell did, was we, using some machinery due to Boutet de Montvel and Guermy of theory Fourier integral operators of Hermitian type. So this is a fairly sophisticated machinery. All these authors were actually unaware of the fact that the same technique has already been used for precisely the same situation, but without using the reproducing kernels, but applying it directly to Tetris operators by these three suspicious characters, one of which is sitting with us here. So by Bornemann, Meyrenken and Martin Schlichtmeier in 1994. So. I don't know if Zeldic actually was ever aware that he was redoing what you did in your paper, but...
I wrote it later, so that he's sorry that
apparently
just completely missed it because he's working in quantum chaos. So this was a different community, so he apologized that we need to read
this. The moral of this is that you should not work in quantum chaos. Okay. Nowadays there are some other approaches due to Malmarinescu using scatter gaps and also some other ones due to Boom Berenson and Robert Berman, which use kind of complex geometry techniques. But still, this method, which was used by Bordemann, Meyrenken, and Schlichtmeier, is the strongest one, and eventually. If Martin does not do it before me this afternoon, then I will describe it in my lectures how this is done very, very roughly.
Okay, but I will do it. So.
Very good, then so I will do some other things.
Yeah. I think you should also mention that, that I together with Alexander Karapetov. So, of course, what we say was not done.
He's coming a few lines later on, so here is the next slide. So this was for compact manifolds, which I mentioned historically was the first. The general setting of domains in CN of other manifolds was one can do it by getting the asymptotic expansion of the kernels and of the Bresen transform using some techniques from complex analysis, from the analysis of D-bar operator, and notably some results about Fefferman and Boutet de Montvel, Schoestrand and Kersman and others on the behavior of a Berman kernel as a boundary. So one, the better way one can handle the asymptotics of the kernels and of the Bresen transforms is I did in the late 1990s. And for Tetris operators, one, even in the context of domains, eventually one needs to use the same technique as Martin and the other two Germans, of which one was actually from Canada, they did in 1994. There are also other approaches for Riemann surfaces. One can calculate as a response geometric, one can calculate it basically using bare hands and uniformization theorem. This was done by Klimek and Vashnevsky in the early 1990s. And for the Euclidean case, we did it for the polynomials here on Monday. But for general functions, one can do it for more general functions. This was done by Lukober, and there was also a more general result by Bosley, but it contains an error, which, as far as I know, has not been fixed, so it's probably unresolved. And in the context of bounded symmetric domains, actually the one who did it first and long before the other was Bresen himself. So it's appropriate that the whole thing is named Bresen and Bresen Tetris quantization. So he did it on bounded symmetric domains, or more generally on symmetric spaces, complex symmetric spaces. there was some generalization by Boston Russian player. Karabekov, well, this might be a misprint, I'm not sure, it should probably, it says 1985, I'm not sure it is not 1995, so he was, it must be right. So he was, he dealt with this polarizations having the extra property of respecting the separation of variables, homomorphic and anti-homomorphic. This was mentioned yesterday at the end of Professor Schlichenmeier's talk. And so the Berzin tapless polarization is the one with separation of variables of the anti-weak type. The Berzin polarization is of weak type, the homomorphic and anti-homomorphic interchange. And he has very nice results about classification and about abstract characterization, which goes around all these difficulties with these scales, etc. He also then made with Martin Schlichenmeier another nice paper where he identifies the Berzin tapless polarization within this classification, these classifying forms. And as I said, there are some other approaches. So today there is also a nice.
This case, I think, one of the which is not in the title, but one of the things is all that we showed asymptotic expansion of the Berzin transform for harmonic compact field manifolds.
Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, in the 1994 paper, you were dealing only with tapless operators, not with reproducing kernels, and not with the Berzin transform. So the Berzin transform was handled by you and Karabekov in this paper in the writing and writing. There's also a nice review paper from I think 4 years ago by Martin, where a lot of this stuff is explained in a very nice way. So let me get to exposing some elements of some techniques that are needed in the proofs. I will need to review some prerequisites about several complex variables. I will again give the proof just for domains in CN. I leave the manifolds to locally. Every manifold is just a domain, so even Scholler one needs to do the analysis in the domains and the. Leave the rest for the rest. So let me stick to the domains in CN. As I said, a real valid function on this domain is called strictly true subharmonic if its matrix of its mixed second order derivatives, one holomorphic and anti holomorphic derivative, is positive definite. Another way of saying that is that if you take the restriction of this function phi to any complex hyperplane, so you fix some z, you fix some V in CN, and you take just a function of one complex variable T, which turns T to phi of Z plus TV. So you take a complex line and you restrict your phi to this complex line. So this function of one complex variable, this restriction to the complex line, should be a strictly subharmonic function on the domain where it is defined. So these are the strictly subharmonic functions that are precisely the Kelly potentials of positive definite matrix. Primary metrics. Next, a domain in a complex space CN with smooth boundaries called strictly pseudo-convex. If there exists a so-called strictly plus harmonic defining function, what is that? So the defining function is something which is positive on the domain, zero on the boundary, and gradient non-vanishing on the boundary. And strictly plus harmonic defining function means that minus R, should be also in addition strictly proportional harmonic in some neighborhood of the closure. So you can think of defining functions like taking the distance function to the boundary, making it positive inside, negative outside the domain. So this is a defining function. So it's basically a boundary distance. Except that far away from the boundaries may stop to be continuous, there may be some singularities, like if you take the unit ball, you take the distance function from the boundary, so there's a singularity at the origin, because you have a cusp. One smooths this to avoid the singularities inside, and one gets this defining function. So we, throughout the rest of the discussion, R will be a fixed strictly pseudo-convex defining function for a strictly pseudo-convex domain. One has just defining function and one has just pseudo-convex domains. one should say that pseudo-convex domains are the natural domains in several complex variables on which holomorphic functions live. So what do I mean by that? In one complex variable, if you are given any region in a complex plane, you find a holomorphic function which is defined on such a precisely on that domain and cannot be analytically continued anywhere further. I mean, on every point of the boundary there is some singularity. So every domain in the complex plane is a natural domain for holomorphic functions. You find a holomorphic function which is on this domain and doesn't extend to any larger domain. In several complex variables, this is not the case. For instance, if you take the domain in C2, two complex variables of this form, so kind of annulus. So any holomorphic functions on this domain actually extends to the holomorphic function of the entire modulus of Z less than 2. The gap is automatically filled. So in several complex variables there are domains which are not domains of holomorphic form functions, in the sense that any holomorphic function on the domain automatically extends to some larger domain. So the domains which are domains from holomorphy, which means there exist functions which are precisely on this domain and cannot be extended to anything larger, these are precisely the pseudo-convex domains. And the strictly pseudo-convex domains are just the ones which are the pseudo-convex domains which are manageable. It's just a similar distinction between the convex domains and strictly convex domains in RN. I mean, strictly convex means you have some nice structure on the boundary, no flat pieces, etc. So strictly pseudo-convex domains in CN are the manageable ones on which holomorphic functions live. So here is finally our main theorem B, B for Berezin. If omega is a smoothly bounded strictly pseudo-convex domain in CN, we take psi as strictly closed harmonic function of omega, so it is a potential of some calorimetric. And suppose we have a hypothesis about the behavior of this psi at the boundary. So e to minus psi should be the defining function for the domain. Inside of all those who have some experience with differential geometries, it just says that the corresponding metric is complete, but it is not very flat. And it will be a little more precise for this in a few minutes. So, under this hypothesis, we take the weights of this form e to bar minus alpha times the covalent potential times the determinant of d to bar phi, so the volume element corresponding to the metric given by the scalar potential phi. Then as alpha tends to plus infinity, again alpha will be 1 over the Planck constant, so this means Planck constant tends to 0. And alpha is also assumed to take only integer values. This is a technical difficulty which I will comment later on. Then we have here an asymptotic expansion of the reproducing kernels, namely the corresponding reproducing kernel for this weight, which we will denote by this k sub alpha. On the diagonal, it has this asymptotic expansion. The reciprocal of the weight, this is what we observed also in the context of the Fox plane and the disk and the ball. So kernel, reproducing kernel on the diagonal is reciprocal of the weight times alpha n over pi n. This was a normalizing constant to make things of total mass 1. I told you that even if you omit it, it turns up automatically from some pops up from somewhere else. So here it pops up also into this asymptotic expansion. And then there is an asymptotic series in the negative powers of alpha, some coefficient over alpha to power j. So in other words, alpha is 1 with a Planck constant, so it is some coefficient bjx times h to power j, so precisely the asymptotic series in powers of the formal power series in Planck constant which we need. The leading order term b0 here is just this determinant of d bar phi, so just the volume element. And we have, so this is the asymptotic behavior of the reproducing kernel. Then we have the asymptotic behavior of the Berezin transform. Again, it comes in as a differential operator times powers of the Planck constant, or the negative power of alpha, whereas the leading order one is just the identity operator, and the first order one, p1, is just the Laplace-Bertrand operator corresponding to this metric, the calorimetric determined by the calor potential phi. So this is exactly the theorem which we need for the Bayesian quantization. In the previous examples which we had for omega the unit ball, including the disk, our choice for psi would be the logarithm of 1 minus 1 the square, which is restricted to the subharmonic, e to minus phi. It's just 1 more minus mod z square, so as a boundary, it behaves like a distance to the boundary. So this precisely means that e to minus phi is indeed a defining function. So these two hypotheses that we have are satisfied. And this b0, this is the terminal, the volume element. If you compute it, it just gives you 1 over 1 minus mod z square to the power n plus 1. Now, if you recall, let me try to go back. You recall these examples which we had. The examples, the Fock space, the disk, and the ball, the weight, and the corresponding reproducing kernel. So the reproducing kernel on the diagonal was just a reciprocal of the weight, except that there was some shift in the exponent. Shift by n plus 1 here, shift by minus 2 here, no shift here. So this shift actually comes precisely from this volume form. This B0, this volume form, using precisely this n plus 1, this shift which we have. So in this way, we recover the examples we have for the ball and for the disk. And I should say that it also works for the Fock space, for where the Euclidean potential is just the model of the square. And in this case, if you take the volume element, Euclidean element, so this B0 will be 1, so there will be no shift in the exponent. So now there are two choices. The one is that I will start giving the details about the proof, which Martin promised to give in the afternoon anyway. And the other one is the other one is from that I stop at this moment and continue tomorrow. So thank you very much for your attention.
Any questions? Yeah, I have.
Oh yeah, please.
Some questions. What is the advantage of doing the non-compatibility? What is the advantage of considering non-compatibility for
non-compatibility? Yeah. Automatically?
Yeah. What is the advantage of
commutativity? For the quantization, you mean that the commutator of two operators plus also the Poisson bracket. The Poisson bracket is there, and so you need to make things non commutative in such a way that the non commutativity is greater by the Poisson bracket. So that's why you need non commutativity.
So another thing is, do we have any experiment that really we can see what happens when
experiment? Well, of course, there are many experiments witnessing the quantum nature. Things can only be described in quantum terms. There is no classical description. This is what made Max Planck start quantum mechanics, starting the black body radiation and all that. And but having an now I am not sure if I understood completely. Having an experiment which would show that at the Planck constant step to zero, this quantum changes into the classical. So this is something which cannot really be realized as an experiment. It just means that, as I explained, letting one constant tend to zero means you are looking at the things in your experiment from the larger and larger perspective, not from the atoms, but looking at people, looking at planets, looking at galaxies. In that case, the quantum phenomena basically become negligible, and you recover the classical mechanics of Newton. So in this case, I mean, the everyday world is just a proof that quantum things are negligible from a macroscopic perspective, which I believe answers your question.
Okay, thanks again for your attention. and gentlemen, so